and welcome Michelle Dean from the class of 2016, who will sing the national anthem. Welcome, the 15th president of the University of Utah, David W. Pershing.
Please be seated. Good evening and welcome to this celebration. First, congratulations to all of you, the class of 2016. We appreciate all of you who are present here in the Huntsman Center for this commencement, as well as those who are joining us via KUED television and are live streaming on our website, utah.edu. We gratefully acknowledge our special guests seated on the platform. So I will ask them to please stand as they are announced and remain standing. Graduates and friends, please hold your applause until we've recognized everyone. Ben McAdams, Mayor of Salt Lake County. Kimberly Henry, Associate Commissioner of the Utah System of Higher Education. Members of the Utah State Board of Regents. Franz A. Davis, Vice Chair. Jessalee Anderson, Nina Barnes, Bailey Bothorp, John Zinger. Members of the State Board of Education, Laura Belknap and Leslie Castle. Members of the University's Board of Trustees, Michelle Madsen Chair, Phil W. Klinger Vice Chair, Spencer F. Eccles Treasurer, Julie Barrett, H. David Burton, Lisa Eccles, Christian Gardner, Ambra Jackson, Christina Ortega, Steve Price, and Taft E. Price. Former University of Utah President, Geraldine S. McIntyre. The deans and directors of the university's schools, colleges, and museums, members of the president's administrative council, and this year's outstanding public school teacher, Lori Kopasz. Welcome to you all. Thank you for being here. The men and women receiving their degrees tonight reflect the educational diversity of this university and the individual interests and passions of all of you students, from art, business, and biology, to communications, engineering, nursing, and psychology. Every corner of our campus is represented. In total, we are celebrating 8,291 graduates. This talented and diverse class came to us from 23 Utah counties, all 50 states, and 92 foreign countries. Our oldest graduate tonight is a graduate student and is 73 years young. Our youngest undergraduate is just 17. Each is an integral thread in the remarkable fabric of our university community. For example, consider Leslie Felder from Salina, Utah, who is graduating with a degree in Human Development and Family Studies. Leslie describes herself as a full-time student, a full-time mom, and yes, a platoon sergeant in the Army Reserves. Leslie spent 15 months serving in Iraq, but more recently, her hours have been spent in the Marriott Library's family reading room with her children nearby. She plans to continue her education with the ultimate goal of becoming a doctor. Now, you will note that Leslie is wearing a red, white, and blue tassel and cords, as are all the candidates for graduation who are members of the military. At this point, I would like to ask all of you to please stand and be recognized, along with Leslie and anybody else who's here as family and friends who have served in the military as well. So stand up and let us recognize you. Thanks to all of you for your service to our country. Jacob Knoll from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, is graduating in International Studies. Jacob is the recipient of the Ivory Prize for Student Leadership. He launched a program called Labs for Liberty, which in just 1 year helped 65 veterans receive service dogs to reduce the impact of post-traumatic stress disorder. He also converted a house into a retreat where veterans and their families can vacation free of charge. Ashley Cleveland from Atlanta, Georgia, is receiving a master's degree in city and metropolitan planning. Ashley experienced chronic homelessness as a child. She has volunteered extensively with the Road Home, AmeriCorps, and currently works for the Salt Lake Neighborhood Development Department, focusing on city planning and homeless services. She has some great advice for the class of 2016. Show up yourself. Take as much as you can from the experience and try to apply it to what you love. The rest will follow. Andrew Gallinger from Rock Springs, Wyoming, was born with cerebral palsy right here in the University of Utah's hospital. He weighed just 2 pounds. His parents were told it was unlikely that he would survive. But with love and care, every day he grew stronger. Later, it was predicted he would never walk, but he completed a 5K race last summer. It is his incredible will and determination that have carried him to this day. Today, 23 years after he entered the world at the U, Andrew is now graduating from the U with a BS in communications. Congratulations to all of you. I wish we had time to talk about all of our graduates individually, but I can briefly tell you what each shares in common. Today's success was preceded by years of late nights, yeah, remember that? Early mornings, personal sacrifice, and sheer tenacity. Most of you have juggled jobs, and many, as Leslie did, have family responsibilities along with your education. During this journey, it is likely you have learned to stand alone, and also likely you've learned to rely on others. Students, you leave this campus proudly recognized as graduates of the University of Utah. But it's unlikely you reach that milestone on your own. I would now like to give you an opportunity to recognize the family and friends who have supported you during your educational journey. Let's give the other people here a round of applause for helping. university faculty and staff also celebrate with you today and your remarkable achievements. Please take this moment to show your appreciation of their efforts on your behalf. With the conferral of your diplomas, you have reached a mighty milestone. You are no longer students. You're entering the real world. You are well prepared for this transition, or you wouldn't have arrived at this point. Still, for some, this new beginning is likely filled not only with well-deserved excitement, but maybe also a little fear and trepidation. In the business world, there's a principle called FUD: fear, uncertainty, and doubt. It's a strategy used in some political campaigns, marketing, and sales campaigns. Those who are graduating from the David Eccles School of Business today can tell you it can be an effective tool for persuasion. It causes people to act in predictable ways by playing on their deepest worries. It is also capable of immobilizing corporations or you and hindering your ability to progress and succeed. I understand that the headlines today, yesterday, and the last few months may be creating some FUD in your mind. But I would like to assure you that many generations who have gone before you have experienced exactly those same feelings, created in part by the world around them. If you don't believe me, do what everybody does. Google it. You will find descriptions, recessions and severe economic downturns in the early 2000s, in the 1990s, in the 1980s. Are you seeing a pattern here? If that isn't bad enough, however, think about this. Think about the graduates three generations ago and how they felt when they were sitting in Kingsbury Hall in June of 1942, 7 months after the attack of Pearl Harbor. Cynical headlines have spelled doom and gloom for many graduating classes. I graduated with a Bachelor's of Science degree in Chemical Engineering in 1970. Yes, that was a long time ago. There was no downturn in the economy that year. That would actually come later in the decade. Then it was the Vietnam War that was dominating the headlines. Because of a low draft number, I set aside multiple amazing job offers and wonderful graduate school scholarships and enlisted in the U.S. Public Health Service. At that time, it appears things were going wrong for me. And it could have. It would have been easy for me to become immersed in fear, uncertainty, and doubt. But in actuality, my assignment, which was to find ways to decrease air pollution emissions from coal combustion, would dramatically and positively change the course of my own life. It led me to graduate school and eventually to the University of Utah, first as an assistant professor, and then eventually to where I am today. So as you contemplate the headlines, remember three things. First, every generation before you has had big concerns, and each has gone on to aid the progression of society through individual actions. Second, don't let FUD stand in the way of becoming what you intend to be. Write your own headlines. And finally, when things go wrong, and this is the most important, they will go wrong sometimes, remember that those apparent failures may well be exactly the catalyst you need to see a new, better vision for your own future. In them, you may find the greatest of new opportunities. It has been an honor to be your president. You are amazing students. Best wishes for the future that you deserve. Thank you so much. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ruth Watkins, Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, who will introduce the extraordinary faculty members, graduate students, and postdoctoral fellows being recognized tonight for their ability to positively influence the scholars and researchers at the university. But before Ruth comes up, we want and announces the faculty's awards, I would like to recognize Dr. Frank Brown, Dean of the College of Mines and Earth Sciences, a position that he has held for over 25 years. Frank, come on up and join me here. Frank is our longest serving dean, and he also carries the title of University Marshal. In this capacity, he leads the faculty procession and is responsible for carrying the ceremonial mace that we bring at commencement. We honor him tonight on the occasion of his last commencement as our marshal. Frank is retiring in his role of dean, but thankfully he will remain on the faculty and in the classroom. Thank you, Frank, for your extraordinary leadership, both in your college and here at commencement. You have been a true statesperson whose actions have always been guided by advancing the University of Utah. We are deeply grateful. Congratulations. Dr. Watkins.
Good evening. May I also add my congratulations to the class of 2016. It's an honor to commemorate your achievements tonight. As a university community, we celebrate your success. It is now my pleasure to announce the awards for Distinguished Teaching, Distinguished Scholarly and Creative Research, Distinguished Faculty Service, Distinguished Innovation and Impact, and Distinguished Graduate Student and Postdoctoral Mentor. We also want to recognize the recipients of the Calvin and Janelle Hatch Prize for Excellence in Teaching and the 2016 Distinguished Professors, Public Service, Honors, Presidential and University Professors, as well as the Outstanding Public School Teacher. Those honored this evening were nominated by their peers, their students, and alumni. They are outstanding educators and researchers who are making a difference in the lives of our students. They create transformative educational experiences in classrooms and lecture halls and in laboratories. Each of them shares a passion for intellectual inquiry and an infectious enthusiasm for their areas of expertise. They challenge, they mentor, they inspire, and they elevate those around them. I encourage you to read more about these exceptional individuals in your programs.
Yeah.
Wow, what remarkable people. I want to ask you all that were honored if you would please stand and let's give them one big round of applause. It's now my honor to announce the recipient of the Rosenblatt Prize for Excellence. In 1993, Joseph and Evelyn Rosenblatt and their family established an endowment at the University of Utah in honor of Joe's parents, Nathan and Tilly. The Rosenblatt Prize for Excellence, now in its 33rd year, is the highest honor that the University of Utah can bestow upon a faculty member. It recognizes achievement that transcends the ordinary in teaching, in research, and in administrative effort. The Rosenblatt Prize is awarded based on the recommendations of a distinguished selection committee. The 2016 recipient of the Rosenblatt Prize for Excellence is Distinguished Professor James Elringer. James, will you please rise and be recognized? Dr. Elringer has devoted nearly four decades to the University of Utah Department of Biology. He's the recipient of numerous awards, including the U's Student Choice Award, the Distinguished Research Award, the Governor's Medal for Science and Technology, and, this is big, we just learned this week, he was elected to the National Academy of Sciences. Dr. Elringer received the Rosenblatt Prize for Excellence during a very special presentation last evening. Congratulations once again from the entire University of Utah community.
Congratulations to all of our faculty and student honorees. You're an amazing group and we're very proud of you. It is now my pleasure to introduce our student speaker. Baccalaureate students graduating with honors and those nominated by their college were invited to submit a written essay for consideration by a selection committee of students, faculty, and staff. 11 semifinalists were chosen to audition for the opportunity to represent you, the graduates, here tonight. All of the finalists' speeches were exceptional. But Charles Kowankowski, who is graduating today with a Bachelor of Science in Economics and an honors Bachelor of Science in Political Science, was selected to ultimately speak on behalf of the class of 2016. Charles?
Thank you. President Pershing, Dr. Slaughter, distinguished faculty and guests, and members of the class of 2016, it is my honor to speak on behalf of all of the students graduating today. You know, when I started to prepare this speech, I knew above all I wanted to say something unique and valuable to my classmates. I quickly realized there was going to be a lot of difficulty with this goal. Everything I wanted to say about our time here at the University of Utah, our classmates, our professors, and our future was a huge cliche. And this was frustrating at first, and I kept trying to come up with something, anything, that might be just a bit more original. The harder I tried, however, the more cliched my ideas became. Then during one sleep-deprived night, burning furiously through an essay to be turned in the next morning, I realized something. I realized why everything I wanted to say about our time here at the University of Utah sounded so overworked. And more importantly, I realized how necessary it was going to be to stop fighting it. So, I ask you to bear with me for a moment and embrace the cliche. Cliche number one, look how much we've changed. We all went in overconfident kids who thought we knew everything. And we all came out overconfident young adults who know we know everything. But there is not one of us here who can look back and say that the person we were years ago, walking into our first class, is the same person sitting here today. If your experience has been anything like mine, you would barely recognize that younger version of yourself. 4 years ago, I didn't yet understand who I was, or what I wanted, what I stood for, much, if anything, about the world, or my relationship to it. And I'm still not sure that I do. But in the last 4 years, the University of Utah has given each and every one of us the experience and the intellectual foundations to ask those questions and to shape our futures. Cliche number two, do not forget what you've learned here. The changes we have all undergone over the past years have been defining. It is not enough to simply look back fondly on these memories, or even enough to be grateful for the education we have been privileged to receive. I beg of you, do not let go of the things you have learned at the University of Utah. The ideals, the connections, the eye-opening moments, and most of all, the hopes and the ambitions that have taken hold of you. The world has enough cynics. It does not need another. There are far too many people who will tell you about what you cannot do. Do not allow the limited imaginations of others to bind you. Take the work, the struggle, the sleepless nights, every failure you've endured, and every victory you've achieved here, and build upon it. Take these experiences and construct the life that you want. A life that inspires you. A life for which the education at this university has prepared you. Cliche number three, we have become a family. When we remember our time here at the University of Utah, be it today or in 10 years, I doubt the principles of microeconomics is going to be the first thing that comes to mind. Honestly, the first thing is going to be the lack of parking. But after that, we'll remember the times that we shared with good people, the experiences that we shared as a community. We'll remember the professors that were more than teachers, the ones that lit a passion we did not know we had. We'll remember the friends we made, those friends that became an adopted family. The memories that last are the ones built upon laughter, love, struggle, and tears. These kinds of memories are only found within a true community, and this university and this class is first and foremost a community. I take pride in being a member of this class, and I ask you to bring this sense of community with you wherever you go next in life, and continue to do so, whatever your future lives hold. I believe the reason everything I wanted to say about our time here sounds so cliched is because the University of Utah has given us a model college experience. It was an experience that surpassed my expectations of what college should be. It gave us much more than just some training and a degree. We were given a platform to grow, perspective and purpose to take into life, and a family that changed our lives forever. This is truly a unique class, and we have a great deal of potential. I know. I've sat with you in classes. I've cheered, danced, debated, and grown with this class. As we embrace our futures together, I ask you to use this potential to its fullest capacity. To not do so would be a crime. Take the things you have learned about yourself at this university and use it. Use it to build and contribute to a better tomorrow. We have been given far too much to do anything less. I will leave you with a quotation from one of my favorite authors, David Mitchell. It is one that has inspired me, and it highlights the lesson I hope we have all learned from our time here together. Mitchell writes, "Our lives are not our own. We are bound to others, past and present. And by each crime and every kindness, we birth our future." Class of 2016, congratulations. May your futures together be as bright as the times we have shared here at the U. Thank you.
Thank you for your perspective, Charles. And we agree, the class of 2016 is unique and uniquely positioned to create a better tomorrow. And we look forward to the future your talents, dreams, and ambitions will create. It is now my pleasure to invite Michelle Madsen, Chair of the University of Utah Board of Trustees, to confer the honorary degrees. Michelle?
Congratulations to our 2016 graduates. Each year on this special occasion, the University of Utah confers honorary doctoral degrees on men and women whose service to country, education, the professions, business, government, the arts, and good causes is of such high order and significance as to warrant an honorary degree, the highest honor bestowed by the university. On behalf of the university's Board of Trustees, I will now introduce the four individuals who have earned this prestigious recognition. Will Kem C. Gardner please rise, and will Trustee Christian Gardner and Dr. Taylor Randall, Dean of the David Eccles School of Business, please escort him to the podium. In consideration of your extraordinary impact as a builder of Utah's economy and community, and in recognition of your passionate concern for the well-being of the state and the leadership you have provided to ensure a better future for its residents, the University of Utah, with the approval of its Board of Trustees, presents Kem C. Gardner with the honorary degree, Doctor of Business.
That's pretty impressive. Thank you.
Congratulations, Dr. Gardner. Will Annette Nielsen Gay please rise, and Trustee David H. Burton and Dr. Steve Alder, Vice Chair of the Department of Family and Preventive Medicine, please escort her to the podium. In, In consideration of your remarkable influence as a humanitarian and philanthropist, and for your contributions to public health, including the creation of a U.S. accredited college in Africa, and in honor of your service as a healthcare worker in the rural clinics throughout Africa, the University of Utah, with the approval of its Board of Trustees, presents Lynette Nielsen Gay with the honorary degree, Doctor of Humane Letters. Congratulations, Dr. Gay. Will Kirk M. Riley please rise, and will Trustee Taft Price and Dr. Henry White, Dean of the College of Science, please escort him to the podium. In consideration of your innovative contributions to science and trailblazing inventions in clinical diagnostics and DNA analysis, for your impact on the advancement of technology in Utah, your leadership of biofire diagnostics and first responder of biofire defense, and for your commitment to grow and protect local technology companies, the University of Utah, with the approval of its Board of Trustees, presents Kirk M. Ryrie with the honorary degree, Doctor of Science. Congratulations, Dr. Ryrie. Will George D. Smith please rise, and will Trustee Phil Klinger and Dr. Martha Bradley, Associate Vice President for Academic Affairs, please escort him to the podium. In consideration of your entrepreneurial and literary achievements, your deep influence on the published industry in Utah, robust research in the history that shaped the West, philanthropic work, and longtime service through the Carter Center guarding democracy and the rights of women, and for your commitment to strengthening the community, the University of Utah, with the approval of its Board of Trustees, presents George D. Smith with the honorary degree, Doctor of Humanities. Congratulations, Dr. Smith. And once again, congratulations to all of our honorary degree recipients.
It is now my great honor to introduce our commencement speaker, Anne Marie Slaughter. Dr. Slaughter is the president and CEO of New America, an influential public policy institute. As a former director of a policy planning portion of the U.S. State Department, she oversaw a major review of U.S. diplomatic and development priorities. She is the author of a renowned article, Why Women Still Can't Have It All, and a book entitled Unfinished Business, Women, Men, Work, Family. Dr. Slaughter holds a doctorate in international relations from Oxford University and a law degree from Harvard. Please welcome Anne Marie Slaughter.
Thank you, President Pershing. So when I was in college, back when the dinosaurs that you have so many wonderful skeletons of here in Utah roamed the earth, I mastered the rule of three. No matter how complicated the subject I was trying to study, it was always easier to remember it if I broke it into three parts. So today is a day of emotion and excitement for all of you. You're going to be hearing and thinking and feeling many things. But I hope when it's all done, when you leave, you will remember three very important points. First, care is as important as career. In so, not yet. So in so many ways, college is about career. When you come to college, you come to be educated broadly, what Montaigne referred to as furnishing the back room of your mind. But you're also preparing for a future career. And for those of you who are graduating today from professional schools and in PhD programs, your time here has been directly about learning the knowledge and acquiring the skills for your career. What do we mean when we talk about a career? It's a professional journey, one that we hope will ascend or at least allow you to continue learning and growing throughout your life. And it is a way of earning a living. In many ways, your career is a lifelong process of investing in yourselves, in the skills, the knowledge, and personal growth and development. Care is investing in others. It is work that is often unpaid, although there are also many paid care careers, caring professions like healthcare, teaching, or ministry. But care is typically valued far less in our society than the work of your careers. Women who are lawyers or business people or engineers or in any other profession, when they step back to care for family members, or even step out of the workforce, often report that they feel they have immediately tumbled in social prestige. They say one minute they're valued for the work they do and the income they bring in, and then suddenly they are much less valued. And men who make those choices to defer a promotion, to be the lead parent for their children, not only have their commitment to their careers cast into doubt, they often find their very manhood is questioned. And yet, those choices to put family first, at least some of the time, are choices that your parents made that were necessary to ensure that all of you are here today, getting your degrees. And someday, you are going to have to make the choices to find the time and the love to be able to care for all of them, for the loved ones, the parents and the grandmothers and the other family members who are here so proud to see you graduate today. So care is vitally important from a social point of view, an economic point of view, indeed even a national security point of view. But care is equally important for all of you, for men as well as for women. You will grow and learn and develop by investing in others just as much as by investing in yourselves. You will discover a new side of yourself, a side of yourself that takes as much pleasure and pride when others succeed as when you do. The value of investing in others is, of course, well understood by many schools of moral philosophy and great religions, including, of course, the LDS Church. That's the first lesson. Care is as important as career. The second is that heart is as important as head. Again, so much of our education is about head. It's about filling all of your heads with the knowledge that you need and the habits of inquiry and intellectual curiosity that will serve you over a lifetime. But many of you, all of you, are going to be pursuing careers in a world in which heart may be the only thing that is not automated. My friend Dov Seidman, who's a business consultant and a journalist, has written that we have moved from the industrial age to the knowledge age or the industrial economy to the knowledge economy to the human economy. In the industrial economy, we hired hands. In the knowledge economy, we hire heads. In the human economy, we will hire hearts. Machines will be increasingly intelligent. And indeed, for those of you who are in computing science, you know, those machines will learn very much the way humans learn. What humans will bring are the traits of our heart, the traits that cannot be programmed into software. Dove calls them creativity, passion, character, and collaboration. I would add compassion and empathy. There's a deeper point here. Dove Seidman is saying that it is heart that is at the core of our humanity. In the Enlightenment, it was head. It was reason ruling the passions. Indeed, think about Descartes. I think, therefore I am. Today, it is feelings and care and empathy and daring that define us. I feel, I think, I dare, I empathize, therefore I am. And it is interesting to think that we use the word heart to refer both to love and to courage. Love and bravery. Heart matters as much as head. That message is particularly important for a university. Indeed, a university is a community, and in any community, we learn to put ourselves in each other's shoes and to feel for them and with them. Without those feelings, without that heart, we cannot have reasoned dialogue. We cannot persuade other people unless we ourselves are willing to be persuaded. This great university has demonstrated that it is a community where a reasoned dialogue can take place, where people can reason, talk, grow, and change from the heart. The third and last lesson, family is as important as fame. So often we talk about work and family as if they were in eternal tension, pulling at us in opposite directions. And I'll be honest, some of the time it does feel like that when your child has an earache and it undoes an entire week of meetings. But none of you would be sitting here without your families, whether those are your biological families or the people whom you love and love you and support you and whom you choose to make your families. We indeed just heard Charles Korankowski say, we have become a family. Family, in its many different incarnations, is not the thing that you have to struggle to make time for as you reach for the stars. Family is the foundation of your ability to thrive. It was one of my own students who taught me that, who in my office looked at me and she said, I don't understand constantly this idea that we have to choose between work and family because without family, I couldn't do any of the things that I do. Family is your foundation. I should also say family keeps you humble, which is valuable as you go forward. I live with two teenage boys. There is no danger that my head will ever swell. That lesson that family is just as important as fame is particularly important for the men in the audience. It is men who often still find that their families, their parents, their wives, even their siblings, that their families define their life success in terms of what they do for a living. Why is that? Why should we expect men to be the constant providers, to stay in the workplace, when perhaps many men would rather provide care rather than cash? would rather reach a different balance with their life partners to invest in their families as well as in their careers. One man wrote me that he had left his job when it was clear that the growth potential of his children was greater than the growth potential of his company. And there is nothing wrong with that. So one more time, here are the 3 points, precepts, principles that I hope you will remember. Care is as important as career, heart is as important as head, and family is as important as fame. These are propositions that are particularly relevant for all of you as graduates of this university in this state. The first inhabitants of this state, the Goshutes, the Shoshone, the Utes, the Paiutes, and the Navajos, worked hard but lived communally. They cared for each other and for the land. When the white settlers came, they created a very distinctive version of life on the frontier. Utah was not the land of the Lone Ranger. It was the land of peach-cutting bees, of husking bees, of quilting bees, and of barn raisings and many other communal activities. It was a state in which many strong women and men invested in their families as much as in their farms, and in which women got the right to vote in 1870, the second territory to do so after Wyoming, and before any of the states. In 1870, 50 years before the 19th Amendment. Utah, as you see on the seal, as you know, is the beehive state. The beehive state for a work ethic that is as communal as it is strong. So go forth. Hug your loved ones today, thank them, and hold them close to your hearts. Build on this great education and continue to learn and to grow. Strive and struggle and work really hard, but always, always make room for the precious, indispensable, and priceless work of care. Thank you very much.
Wow, what great insight. Thank you, Anne Marie, for coming to the University of Utah and helping us learn how we can build a stronger community in a more humane world. As you, the class of 2016, leave our campus in the quest to discover your own futures, I want you to know that you are not alone. You're about to officially join the ranks of distinguished university alumni and a Pac-12 alumni community. Yes, the Alumni Association wants to extend this welcome to you.
Soon you will officially join the ranks of a distinguished Pac-12 alumni community with more than 260,000 worldwide. On behalf of the Alumni Association, we extend a warm welcome. We encourage you to stay involved. We have 17 alumni chapters across the country and in 12 international locations. Take advantage of the services we offer. If you're applying to graduate school, the Alumni Association provides discounts on test prep courses, and we give away more than $550,000 in scholarships every year. If you're preparing to tackle the job market, we provide resources to launch and advance your career. We're here to help you maintain a lifelong relationship with the university, because after all, we love you.
We love you. We all have our reasons. For some, it's the plaque on the wall, remembering youth, love, and simpler times. For others, it's the tickets. An eyewitness to the action, the guts, the glory. They could be on the 50-yard line or nosebleed, doesn't matter.
For some, it's generational. Passed down like jewels, land, or the family business. We love you. It's deep and wide. You see it on thousands of cars, furling in the wind, and adorning every shape and size. We understand this love. More than 260,000 strong, reaching across the country and the globe to stay connected and to serve the students and the university we love. And naturally, we'd love it if you joined us.
We get to proceed with the conferral of degrees. While the size and scale of this ceremony precludes presenting diplomas personally to each one of you, we take this opportunity to make evident our pleasure and pride in the achievements and successes of all of you who are graduating today. Dr. David Keita, Dean of the Graduate School, will present the candidates for graduate degrees. We ask that the candidates stand as they are acknowledged and remain standing until all have been presented. Dave.
President Pershing, it is my distinct honor and pleasure to present the candidates who are to receive the degrees Doctor of Audiology, Doctor of Education, Doctor of Electrical Engineering, Doctor of Musical Arts, Doctor of Nursing Practice, Doctor of Occupational Therapy, Doctor of Pharmacy, Doctor of Physical Therapy, Master of Philosophy, and Doctor of Philosophy. Will the candidates please stand?
By virtue of the authority vested in me, as the President of the University of Utah by the people of Utah, acting through their representatives in the legislature and on the State Board of Regents, and on the recommendations of the faculty of the university and the university's Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the doctoral degree for which you have qualified, which entitles you to all the rights, privileges, and honors thereto pertaining. Congratulations.
President Pershing, it's my honor to present the candidates who are to receive the degrees Master of Arts, Master of Science, Master of Architecture, Master of Accounting, Master of Business Administration, Master of City and Metropolitan Planning, Master of Education, Master of Fine Arts, Master of Music, Master of Engineering, Master of Entertainment Arts and Engineering, Master of Occupational Health, Master of Occupational Therapy, Master of Healthcare Administration, Master of Physical Therapy, Master of Public Administration, Master of Public Policy, Master of Public Health, Master of Human Resource Management, Master of Real Estate Development, Master of Statistics, Master of Social Work, and Master of Science and Technology. Will the candidates please stand?
By virtue of the authority vested in me as the President of the University of Utah by the people of Utah, acting through their representatives in the legislature and on the Board of Regents, and on the recommendation of the faculty of the university and the university's Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the master's degree for which you have qualified, which entitles you to all the rights, privileges, and honors thereto pertaining. Congratulations. Please be seated. Okay, we've now come to the moment the majority of you have been waiting for, the presentation of the candidates for the bachelor's degree. So get ready. First, we want to recognize the distinctive achievement of so many of you, as indicated by the various cords and ribbons that you are wearing. We also celebrate our 10 Binion Center Community Engaged Scholars, the 90 students who will receive the Undergraduate Research Scholar designation, the 20 students receiving honor certificates, and the 143 students graduating with university honors. Congratulations to all of you. Now it is my great pleasure to present the candidates for Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Fine Arts, Bachelor of Music, Bachelor of Science, and Bachelor of Social Work, and Bachelor of University Studies. I would like to invite my colleagues, the academic deans, to present the candidates from their respective colleges. So get ready.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, get ready to clap your hands and stomp your feet as I request the most caring, creative, and inclusive candidates from the College of Architecture and Planning to please stand and be recognized! Thank you. You may be seated.
Oh, Taylor. Sorry.
Will the women and men who will soon sign all of our paychecks approve all of the bonuses and, heaven forbid, justify all of our expenses? The graduates of the David Eccles School of Business, please stand and be recognized. Thank you. You may be seated.
Would the candidates from the College of Education, where graduates excel in teaching and will make a difference as the future teachers of America, please rise and be recognized. Thank you. Please be seated.
Will the candidates from the College of Engineering, who will invent the future with ever better access to information, ability to communicate, and with solutions to the world's problems in energy, food, and water, please stand and be recognized. Thank you. You may be seated.
Will the soul and the heart of America, those who will lift you with their voices, with their images, with their movement, the College of Fine Arts, will you rise and be recognized?
You may be seated.
Will the candidates from the College of Health, who will contribute to the health and wellness of all individuals and families, please stand and be recognized? Thank you. You may be seated.
Will the multilingual, linguistically sophisticated, philosophically inclined, amazing writers, critical thinkers, brilliant communicators, and all-around fantastic people from the College of Humanities please rise and be recognized? Congratulations, and please be seated.
Will the candidates from the College of Mines and Earth Sciences please rise and be recognized? Thank you. You may be seated.
Will the 180 candidates for the degree Bachelor of Nursing Science please stand and be recognized? Mr. President, these outstanding graduates have the head and the heart to provide expert nursing care to you and your families.
Will the candidates from the College of Science, who will change the world with their discoveries, please rise and be recognized? Thank you. You may be seated.
Will the candidates of the College of Social and Behavioral Science, who have been trained to be the solution to social problems facing all individuals, please stand and be recognized? Thank you. You may be seated.
Will the candidates from the College of Social Work, where the values of diversity, inclusion, and social justice are front and center, please rise and be recognized? Thank you. You may be seated.
Now I have to ask all of the bachelor's candidates to rise again. Yay! It is with great pleasure that the university recognizes, stay standing, it is with great pleasure that the university recognizes its undergraduates and welcome those candidates who stand before us into its ranks, into its alumni, and into the fellowship of educated men and women. By the virtue of the authority vested in me as the president of the University of Utah, by the people of Utah, acting through their representatives in the legislature and on the State Board of Regents, and on the recommendation of the faculty of the university and the university's Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the baccalaureate degree or certificate for which you have qualified, which entitles you to all the rights, privileges, and honors thereto pertaining. Please accept our heartiest congratulations. Please be seated. It should be noted that commencement ceremonies for the S.J. Quinney College of Law will be held on Friday, May 13th, celebrating 122 law graduates. Commencement ceremonies for the School of Medicine will be held on Friday, May 20th. 290 degrees will be awarded at that time. Graduates, I encourage you to attend your own college convocations tomorrow. This is your opportunity to gather and commemorate your achievements with those who have supported you. Again, congratulations to each of you. This marks the successful completion of this stage of your educational journey and the beginning of another. We wish you ongoing success, a lifetime of learning, and a future that even exceeds what you have imagined. Audience, please join me in recognizing this talented class one more time. Thanks go to all those who have arranged this commencement and to the University of Utah Wind Ensemble conducted by Scott Hagen. Thank you to everyone who has joined us tonight. We appreciate your participation in this memorable event. Now let us rise in honor of our graduates as the Pride of Utah, the Utah Marching Band, plays our fight song.
Will the audience please remain standing for the recessional? The University of Utah's television station, KUED Channel 7, will air a broadcast of tonight's commencement ceremony on Saturday, May 7th at 5:30 p.m. This concludes the 147th annual commencement and conferral of all certificates and degrees by the University of Utah. Thank you.
Yeah.